thank you all for coming. I want to introduce our speaker tonight, Marshall Zucker. I think most of you probably know him, but he's a retired principal of the Elmont School District, and he's a current religious educator, fortunately here at Beth Orr, and also at Beth Am and the Belmore Merrick Jewish Center, Hebrew High. And Mr. Zucker is a vibraphone, xylophone player and has a fountain of knowledge about music history. So I can't wait to hear what he has to say tonight. Thank you.
The project, and excuse my voice, I've been fighting laryngitis, but a microphone will help a great deal. In the year 2010, Hofstra University sent out an invitation for papers to be presented. So I was turned down for some of the educational journals. What's the educational leadership? You know that magazine, Felix, anybody else knows that. And I figured that, okay, they didn't want it, that's fine, but I was even more interested in this. So their topic was 1935, because it was the 75th year that Hofstra was in as a university. So I thought, I'd like to try this. I'd like to get the challenge of just writing a little bit, an article, nothing more than that. So I sent in a project, and it was the fact that I thought about it, that was the year I know that Benny Goodman played with Teddy Wilson, not for the first time. They had played in the studios before that, but it was a bit of a project that they would play together. And doing that, it was really the first time that there really was, in some degree, inequality between the races in the United States of America. And I would take a great deal of pride that's Benny Goodman that's involved with it. Now, Benny Goodman was the musical force, and every bit of credit that he's given, he deserves. He was not the main driving force. He didn't get up one day and say, gee, I wanna break down the racial barriers of this country. But he was always for the very best kind of music, even before he really hit the major time. And his brother-in-law-to-be was John Hammond. Now, John Hammond's a name that meant a great deal to United States music right through his entire life, right through the 1970s, because he was a discoverer of a lot of people. And John Hammond was, first of all, he came from a very, 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 very wealthy family. He came from the Vanderbilt family. So he, on the one hand, you know, had this kind of background. He wasn't, you know, given things automatically. Well, there's a great joke. The Rockefeller kids, at one point, you know, kids said to them, you must have this, you must have that. Now, one of the Rockefeller kids said, what do you think we are, the Vanderbilts? So the Vanderbilts must have been very, very wealthy. But John Hammond was not a spoiled type individual. He was someone who had an interest in music. He played the viola, he played classical music, but he began getting very interested in jazz music. And he was also very interested in trying to break down racial barriers himself. So he thought about the fact that he knew the piano player Teddy Wilson, and he thought that it would be a very nice thing, if possible, to get them together legitimately without pushing Benny Goodman into it, to see if they could possibly form a tie. So it seems that the great singer Mildred Bailey, who was married to the player, the only player of this instrument, this is a marimba, or it's a form of a xylophone, just a little different than a xylophone, was Red Norvo, who wasn't playing the vibraphone yet, who was married to Mildred Bailey, and they lived in Forest Hills, not too far from where my son lives, on a street called Pilgrim Circle. I don't think it exists anymore. It does? I looked it up. I couldn't find it. It said the house opens up to Queens Boulevard. All right, so what it was there. So they had, Mildred Bailey was a great cook, and people would come and get together. And so nonchalantly, people were playing music, and Benny Goodman joined them, and it was Teddy Wilson and him. And there was a cousin of Mildred Bailey who had a set of drum brushes, and the story was he was either playing on a phone book, he was playing possibly on a suitcase, somebody else said on a drum, but they played together and they sounded great. So this was in July of 1935. All right, so that's when they first played together. So they enjoyed it. John Hammond was happy. And so they made a group. Now, of course, the drummer was not going to be the drummer in the group. He was not the professional that they wanted. But Gene Krupa was the drummer that was playing a great deal. And of course, he became the most famous of all the drummers, like an early matinee idol, very, very well loved. So he deserves credit for it too. So now we have a little trio. It's just a trio of three musicians, no electric, anything of any kind. You have Benny Goodman playing the clarinet, Teddy Wilson playing the piano, and Gene Krupa playing the drums. I'm going to give you an example of them from 1936. Nobody's Sweetheart. Remember, they're in a recording studio, the biggest recording studio at the time, RCA Victor, but they're playing with one microphone, no double bass player, which is significant. Now, you see the double bass player, and you say, why are they playing a musician for that? Very important to have a great bass player, right? So it's extremely important, but there is none. Teddy Wilson is such an outstanding piano player using his left hand. So I'll give you an example of it. All the examples I'm going to give you tonight are up-tempo, so I know that you'll enjoy those very much. So there you have. I mean, this was a group making records now. And again, it's one of those types of records. If anybody's down the dumps, not feeling too happy, listening to one of those records is certainly great, great therapy. And it's an amazing group. So they have a really, really good group, just the three musicians. Now, Benny Goodman also began his big band at this time. Teddy Wilson did not play with the big band. Jess Stacy was the piano player with the big band, and that's what it was at the time. Okay, so let's get a little bit about the people involved so far. John Hammond was born Benny Goodman, just to give you a representative, both Benny Goodman and Gene Krupa born in 1909, right? Teddy Wilson's born in 1913 or 14. John Hammond was born in 1910. He lived in a spectacular house in Manhattan. He became involved with jazz music. He was an advocate for civil rights for all people. So they knew each other certainly well. In fact, Benny Goodman ends up marrying John Hammond's sister a few years after that. So John Hammond just knew that if he was going to do this great deed of getting this kind of involvement, he knew Benny Goodman, and he felt that he could have a role in it. Again, he felt he could steer Benny Goodman the right way. And again, I'm going to tell you, it's a great deal of pride for us that this should have happened with Benny Goodman. And Teddy Wilson was born about 1913. And John Hammond continued introducing people. Some of the people, I think you might even be able to tell me more than I know, but he certainly discovered, given credit for Billie Holiday, Count Basie, Charlie Christian, guitar player, Aretha Franklin, Bob Dylan, and Stevie Ray Vaughan. Now, John Hammond, though, had a feeling that he knew a great deal about it. You know, deep down, who do you think owns all this jazz? A little bit in his mind. And he was a critic, and he made some enemies. And of all people he decided to comment upon was somebody he didn't steer, and that was Duke Ellington. He wrote a very negative comment about one of his great, very lovely pieces. So he felt he could say what he wants, but he certainly did accomplish a great deal, and he's owed a great deal, right through the 1970s. All right, so here we have a trio playing. Now, one thing about the trio is that these are all musicians who took lessons. These are not self-taught musicians. In the whole of jazz, there are certainly a number of them. I mean, we know Errol Garner, great Errol Garner, and I mean, I can't imagine how somebody playing either guitar or the piano is self-taught, but he was. Now, Buddy Rich, the greatest drummer of them all, was playing the drums when he was about 3 years old in an act. Okay, so let's go a little bit about Benny Goodman, since he's from our culture. He was born on May 30th, 1909 in Chicago. Very, very poor, large family, a large number of children in the family. And he's the only one in the group, the small group, that is born into poverty. Now, what happens a few months after this happens, and this is a funny thing too, is that Benny Goodman was encouraged by the saxophone player in his band, one of the saxophone players, Jaime Scherzer, to come down. He wants him to hear another musician. Now, Jaime Scherzer, very popular saxophone player at the time. When I was a camp counselor in Massachusetts, 1978, I used to pick up the mail for my campers, and I saw a return address, Scherzer, for one of my campers. And I said to him, you know, by any chance, was Jaime Scherzer part of your family? He said, yeah, that was my grandfather. So I had him as a camper, which is funny. But the point is that Jaime Scherzer encouraged Benny Goodman to go to this real rundown dive where sailors would go. And the leader of the band there was Lionel Hampton. So they thought that Lionel Hampton would be, you know, somebody who would really fit in very, very well with this group. So one time Benny Goodman just came in to listen to them, and then the next time he came back, he brought his clarinet and he played with them, and Lionel Hampton thought it was terrific. They all thought it was terrific. So now there's a four-piece group. So I'm going to give you an example of the four-piece group once Lionel Hampton was added.
Thank you.
sure you enjoyed that. That piece called A Handful of Keys and was written by Fats Waller, who was a very, very popular piano player, very well loved, and also on the RCA Victor label at the time. So let me just back up a little bit now and show you a couple of reissues of the records that came out early on RCA Victor. Of course, all of the records came out on 78s. The 10-inch shellacs that were very easily breakable, that can hold no more than 3 minutes of music on a side, unless they were 12-inch records. Now, the original Sing, 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 not the live version, but the version made in the studio, was a two-sided 12-inch record. So that was a longer record. But these records were made to be no more than 3 minutes each. So they really got to the point, they weren't able to really, you know, keep them getting longer, and there's not a second wasted on it. So the first song that I played was a song called Nobody's Sweetheart, right? Was that Nobody's Sweetheart. So that was 2 minutes, 45 seconds. It was made on March 27th, 1936 in Chicago, with just the three musicians. And then the one I just played for you was the year after, with Lionel Hampton added. All right, so now there's a large band. Of course, Gene Krupa is the drummer in both the large group and the small group. And the small group comes out. Now, few other big bands had small groups pulled out from them. Now, ironically, you know whose birthday it is today? Artie Shaw. Now, Artie Shaw had the big band that was very popular, another clarinet player, another person with a Jewish background. Artie Shaw was not proud of his Jewish background. Benny Goodman didn't go around yelling about it, but he had a certain degree of pride. He learned at the synagogue, where they got free instruments. But Artie Shaw was from Boston, which at the time certainly was 1910, not a hotbed of friendship from what I've read. And so he was just a much different, very, very strange individual. He did some good things as far as breaking down racial barriers, too. Billie Holiday sang with his band for a little while, and he had a small group within the large group, too. They were called the Gramercy Five. And to get their group to have a little bit of a different sound, the piano player played the harpsichord in the band. But he made some movies. I think he was much more famous for all of his marriages than he was really for his music. Artie Shaw was married to Lana Turner, to Ava Gardner, Evelyn Keyes, who played the sister in Gone with the Wind, and about seven or eight other people. I think he had eight marriages. Charlie Barnett outdid him, but he was a lot of fun all the time. But Artie Shaw, I wouldn't have wanted to be in his band. If he got annoyed one night, he would just walk off. One night he left the band and he went to Mexico. Well, the band was, he was very strange with this. It was up to him. He left music completely in 1955. So again, I don't ever see myself doing a real project on Artie Shaw. But Benny Goodman, yes, I'm really somebody who really was proud of his music. So the large band was popular. I'm not as much of a big band person because of the instrument I play. You don't see it in the big band too much, but the small group existed separately. And what happened is they did play live at times, but then once they really became popular, in the late, middle 30s, Benny Goodman was the most popular musician in the entire country. No question about this. And really, he had no stage personality whatsoever. Benny Goodman was interested just in music. Now, I keep up with Terry Gibbs. He's 98 and a half now. He's a vibes player who played with Lionel Hampton, played with Woody Herman, had his own groups. And he talks about the one time they were rehearsing, and Terry Gibbs said, great band leader, absolutely. He was only concerned in himself and his music. So one time, it was very cold in the apartment. Said, Benny, it's really cold here. I said, you're right. And he went in the other room, and he came back wearing a sweater. You know, he was just thinking about himself. He didn't think about turning heat up for anybody else. So, that's what he was interested in. And he was willing to go along with this breakdown in racial barrier. And it's a great thing. Now, he was the first movie where black and white together, Hollywood Hotel, a movie from about 1938 or so. Now, certainly it was made so it's a separate scene, so it could be cut out when it was sent down south to be seen. But still, it's the four of them playing together. Four very different personalities. Two of them were extroverts. Two of them were introverts. Gene Krupa, Lionel Hampton, very, very great showman, very terrific. I saw Lionel Hampton twice when he was over 70 years old, and he, you know, still dancing and singing incredible. And I saw Benny Goodman in 1982, and just a great small group. But it was just about the music. He would say one or two things. He would introduce the song. The next song I'm going to do is, oh yeah, it's easy to remember. Now for him, that was a major, you know, joke to be able to say that. But he was really just interested in the music, to say. Now, the popularity of his group, everything was revolving around him. So big thing happened in January of 1938, January 16th, 1938. The first time that jazz music is going to be played at Carnegie Hall. And this is a big deal. I mean, a truly big deal. It's sold out. If you ever see the movie that I'll get to a little bit later that's made about him in the 50s, you see that there's so many people there that there's chairs set up on the stage for people who bought tickets. There's no other room for them. So they're on the stage in the background. So it's a great concert, and the band plays, and the also, the small group plays. Now, it's unknown that a recording of this existed. But one time when a recording of it was made, and one copy was given to him, and it was in his closet. So when he was moving out of the apartment he was living in 1950, they found this set of I don't even know what they were. They call acetates, a certain way that they recorded. And certainly, you know, it's not high fidelity, but it was certainly released and was a very, very big hit in 1950. And I'll give one example of it right now, and then I'm going to have one a little bit later. must have been so exciting being there at that night. It must have been the most incredible thing in the world. It's the first time that Carnegie Hall has this type of music. And, you know, it's being reviewed for the Times the way that a classical music concert would be reviewed. And it was a great thrill. I mean, and it was not something that the musicians were very comfortable at the beginning of it. It took Gene Krupa to do something to loosen them up. But that certainly was great. It's not high fidelity, but it was terrific. So what happened in the early 50s, this is a copy of one of the early copies of the concert. It came out in either three volumes or in a three-volume set. It was reissued again. I guess it was the Benny Goodman 25th year on records. They sent, you know, issued it again. And then the more formal one came out at a very nice set. I don't, the reason for this, I'm not sure why, but it was reissued a third time. But you know something? It was also issued on 45 records, not on 78s, but although 78 records were being issued through the early 1950s. But there was a big war going on in the record world between RCA Victor and Columbia Records. RCA Victor featured the large hole 45 records, and Columbia went for the, not that at this point they were not usually 12 inch except the classicals, 10 inch 33 long playing. So people had 78 Victrolas or whatever form of 78 records, and then they had to get new machines. So it was a real strange thing going on up until the war stopped, and then they started using each other's methods, so that by the, I would guess, the early, middle 50s, both companies were making 33s and 45s. I have, again, I do a lot of these programs for IRA. I did this one, and when I did one about Rodgers and Hammerstein, I have the original 78 album, and the records are in perfect condition. Columbia made a very good product, and they made, so South Pacific, you'd get it either on a 78 set of records, about seven or eight records you would need, or on 45s or 33s. Now, if you had the original 78 machine, the sound of an old 78, and not of an old 78, of a new 78, was monumental. It was a great sound. So even though these are the microgroove, once the 78 wore, of course, it didn't have the same sound, but that's where the best sound came from, ironically. You wouldn't expect that. So, again, that's for the stereo. That's not something that I'm as interested in, the different recreations of it, but you had all of these different items going on until it was more standardized. All right, so here we have the group spelling the others, and at this point, something's beginning to happen in 1938 that musicians are so popular. A few weeks after the concert, Gene Krupa drops out to form his own band. And it's a very popular band, and Gene Krupa is a very, very well-loved musician. I can't say all the same. You know, again, Benny Goodman could be very difficult to work with, but he kept on with the highest standard of groups. Now, he had a couple of difficult periods of time. He had a terrible back problem. He wasn't able to go. I think most of them had volunteered to serve the country, and of course some of them went on to serve, have wonderful bands like Glenn Miller. Artie Shaw wanted to go in as just as a recruit, but he was basically pushed, please form a band. But Benny Goodman continued his groups, and he did continue including other groups to make his bands racially integrated. So that there was a great guitar player named Charlie Christian, who tragically had a very short life, who played with the group. And then other big names went into his group. The great trumpet player from the Duke Ellington Orchestra, Cootie Williams, went into the Benny Goodman Orchestra, and it was a very financially good thing for Cootie Williams. All right, so this band, to give you more information about them, just very, very popular. The musicians respected each other. Although, again, Gene Krupa and Benny Goodman, at points after the concert, you could hear them actually arguing and people, you know, cheering Gene on to play long solos and basically saying, no, you know, that he won't let me do it. So they had to break up after a little bit. Lionel Hampton never had anything to say except good things about Benny Goodman. I met Lionel Hampton in 1980, and he was very, very respectful about it. Teddy Wilson publicly always said the best thing, and they always found their way back to each other. But it wasn't always that easy to work with him. But they were all honored to play together, and they really had a lot of respect for each other. Now, Teddy Wilson also left to form his own band, but Teddy Wilson did not have the kind of personality to be in front of a big band playing magnificent piano play, and he ended up going back and playing with Benny Goodman very often, having his own small groups. Lionel Hampton went out of the Benny Goodman band with financial backing from Benny Goodman, and he had successful big bands right to the very end of his life. I mean, he died at the age of 94 or so in 2002, and he really continued playing very, very well, as best as he could at the older ages, even after being had strokes, numerous strokes. Now, something that always interests me, and Lionel Hampton actually said it to me, that the fact that what they did really paved the way for other things to happen. Jackie Robinson going into Major League Baseball. It's ironic. I spent time with Lionel Hampton. My older brother spent time with Jackie Robinson in junior high, 231 if you pass it. He came to an Arista meeting. So why is it? Why is it that, and the musician, there's almost no times when we hear about people not treating Teddy Wilson and Lionel Hampton with respect. I never heard once among the musicians that there was anything less than the best respect given to these musicians, never. Now, Harry James was in the band at the time. Harry James, whose father, I think, was Jewish. He came from Texas. Nope, never. Ever anything less than the greatest respect. Why is it that Jackie Robinson had so many difficulties with baseball fans, with people on his team, with other teams? Is it that musicians are so much superior to athletes? I don't know. I'm not going to say that, even though I have, you know, I'm certainly like to believe, even though I'm a student musician myself, but it's really incredible why this big difference took place. Maybe we can talk about that a little bit at the end, but it's really kind of sad when you hear about that. Benny Goodman, Lionel Hampton, Teddy Wilson, Gene Krupa always found their way back to each other one way or another, right up until a few months before Gene Krupa died in 1973. And I'll show you a couple of examples of this. I suppose that Lionel Hampton's band must have been engaged at the time, but here are the three musicians, with others added, playing for the Fletcher Henderson Medical Fund. Fletcher Henderson was a band leader, and who ended up, the band was not successful, but all of the arrangements that he wrote for his band, he wrote and gave, and you know, with pay, to Benny Goodman. Benny Goodman gave Fletcher Henderson credit for it. It is Fletcher Henderson's music that the big band plays, but here they played for a benefit to try to help Fletcher Henderson, who unfortunately died a couple of years after that. Then we get to the early middle 1950s, and there's a tremendous, could call it cult, for Glenn Miller. Now, Glenn Miller died in the service of his country in December of 1944. His plane was lost and never found again. And there was a tremendous group of people who loved Glenn Miller. And a movie of his life, supposedly, was made by Universal Film. And he had the good fortune, the film had James Stewart playing Glenn Miller. And he was, you know, he's pretty terrific in it. He really was. I don't consider, my personal opinion, Glenn Miller's band anywhere near Benny Goodman. But again, as I said before, the big band is not as special to me as the smaller groups. But it's a good movie, and James Stewart was really very, very good in it. There was a couple of really great scenes. Gene Krupa was in it with Louis Armstrong and a few other musicians. It was a very good film. A few years before that, there's a film about the Dorsey brothers that they're actually in. It's a real I don't know if you call it cheat, The Fabulous Dorseys, it's called. And Tommy was actually pretty good. It was a silly little film, but there's some great music in that one too. But this is a big doings. And the band that's in it includes the original group, Benny Goodman, Teddy Wilson, Gene Krupa, Lionel Hampton. And in it are some members of his original band, including Jaime Scherzer, who I mentioned before. But there are other great musicians in it, like Herbie Green and Stan Getz as well. Now, ironically, it's because this movie was made that, totally off the subject, that Ella Fitzgerald gets to make the best records that she ever did in the late 50s. Why? Because for this record to be made and Stan Getz to be a part of it, Norman Granz, who was the owner of the record company that Stan Getz played for, had to give his permission for Stan Getz to play for this movie. And he said, that's absolutely fine. He said that to Decca Records, that's perfectly fine as long as when Ella's contract comes up, I get to handle Ella Fitzgerald. And that's when she made her best music too. So this film actually did a few good things. Now, Steve Allen is in it, and Steve Allen is not exactly an actor of the caliber of James Stewart. So it's a corny movie where they make the other movie with James Stewart, June Allison, who I guess is considered a pretty good actress. That, you know, it makes something between their relationship. The chemistry between Steve Allen and Donna Reed is not exactly something that's too exciting. So, and again, you know, he's always concerned about his music. It's kind of silly, but the music is great in it. And also the person who showed Steve Allen how to hold a clarinet the right way and try to learn, his name is clarinet player named Saul Yeager, who played at my bar mitzvah party, who, because the vibes teacher that I had played with Saul Yeager. Bertie and I spoke, what? No, he wasn't in that. He was world's greatest jazz band. That was Bob Haggart and Yank Lawson out of the Bob Crosby band. But Saul Yeager was playing in the Gaslight Club with Sam Milano. Yes. So, you know, the point is, again, it's a lot of our people involved with this. It's worth seeing. It's certainly worth hearing for the music. It certainly was, and a few of these records were made of it, and it's really good music. So they're together again. Now, so let's see other times that they were together. They were together for a World's Fair. Well, okay, this is not February 56, the movie. And then they played at Macy's in New York City in 1959. Teddy Wilson went with Benny Goodman, big doing again. Benny Goodman in the early 1960s went to the USSR as a cultural exchange program. It was very interesting. Pardon? Bill Crow, the bass player. Yeah, he tells stories not the most complimentary about Benny Goodman. And then they made a record together I'll tell you exactly when it was, because I'm going to play an example of it. Now, at this time in the 1960s, we have the four musicians, they're all leaders. It's still the Benny Goodman Quartet, but you know, they have to deal with things a little bit differently. It's high fidelity, good high fidelity at this point. They can make records that are longer than 3 minutes. So I'll give you an example of the good record that they made for RCA Victor in the 1960s. share it well? Right, so that's from, let's see, exactly 1964. And it was a big selling record, people very happy to hear them again. And then they did play together at other times. I remember very clearly they played for the Newport Jazz Festival once it came to New York, June 29th, 1973. I remember I was working in Gimbel's Valley Stream at the time, and I was able to put on a radio and listen to them. And it was, they did play one last time in Saratoga Springs on August 18, 1973. But Gene Krupa was very ill. He died in October of 1973. So that was sad. So that was, of course, the last time they would ever play together again. Ironically, Teddy Wilson and Benny Goodman died within about a month and a half of each other in June and July of 1986. And of course, and John Hammond died in 1989, and Lionel Hampton at 94 in 2002. Of the four original Great Vibes players, three of them, one of them is still 90, is 98 and a half, but Red Norvo and Lionel Hampton all lived to be over 90, so good instrument. This This is a book that was written about them. This was done after my paper, so I was very happy to see this. I'll show you some memorabilia now. There's a book that I just happened to, there was in an English jazz magazine, lovely jazz journal, and I won this because I answered some questions. It's a book completely about the concert that they made. This book is from 1969, remember, Goodman lived and was an active musician until 1986, and this is about every record that he ever made up until 1969. Here's a nice group of something I like very much. I still like these nice little cassettes. I still find them to be very friendly and nice. Again, this is the cover of the book. You can't really get it, but this is what the article was in. There were about 130 papers given, and about a third of them were selected to go in. So, of course, I was very pleased about that. Mine was selected. You know, I was with a bunch of college professors. That publish or perish thing was affecting them. But I was very glad that mine went into it. The best part of it is that now both my son and I are published through Hofstra. He was the editor of the Law Review of his year, so that was very nice. Now, I want to show you some other things about him, about Benny Goodman. This was... I'm sure you could probably get this now on a DVD, but when PBS does a program about someone, they still issue them. But this was a very, very nice program about Benny Goodman. Now, Benny Goodman remained extremely popular right up until, literally until his death. His death was definitely front page news. There's no question about that. This was an Encyclopedia of Jazz, Leonard Feather, very, very fine author. Three forwards, one by the greatest composer of them all, Duke Ellington, and the other two, Benny Goodman and John Hammond, are selected to write. Again, Benny Goodman's not a person of letters, but they ask him. Here is a 1959 Metronome magazine. Now, Metronome was a music magazine that died in 1961. It existed from 1885 to 1961. And it dealt with large bands, and it changed into jazz and you know, mostly jazz music. And I would say in the 1930s to big band, and then when you hear the expression modernists, it really means the jazz musicians that came along after World War II. So here they had a poll, an all-time poll. They asked people to vote. So here's the top 10 in 1959. All right, now, seven of them would be considered modernist musicians, 1959. Benny Goodman comes in number 8. Now, this is 1959. Remember when he was popular? Want to guess who some of the others were in the top 10? Go ahead, guess. Dizzy Gillespie came in number 6. Who else? Charlie Parker, by far, number 1. Did you say Charlie Parker or Charlie Bird? The guitar player? Well, you mean Charlie Parker, Bird, yeah. Number 1 by a big, big, you know. Number two. Number 3, Coltrane is way down there. 59 is just beginning really to get, that kind of blue album comes out. No, not in the top 10. So Miles Davis is 2. Number 3 at the time, as big a musician, if I told you the instrument, it gives it away, the big, big saxophone. The big one. Jerry Mulligan is number 3, and he's in movies at the time. And so, again, another modernist. Dave Brubeck, number 10. I'm doing work on him right now. Another Jewish musician is number 7. Another Jewish musician, number 7. Number 7, Stan Getz, who had the biggest hits. What about the biggest, the most important jazz musician of them all? Who's the most famous? He comes in number 5, which is nice. Great, great, wonderful musician, Lester Young, comes in 4. And we leave out, I think, just one person there's one person, great, great composer, was beginning to get popular then, considered very eccentric, but wonderful composer, Thelonious Monk. Now, in 1957, Mingus is certainly there. I mean, they have about 500 musicians, but at that point, there. What? Monk was wonderful, wonderful music. Now, in 1957, Benny Goodman wins the Hall of Fame. Now, that's the, I think, the six-time Hall of Fame. The first, very good. It's well-deserved. The first one was Louis Armstrong. The second and third are, well, the second is one of the cult people, and that's Glenn Miller. It's the second, which wouldn't get it now. The third, there was a cult for someone who I won't even listen to for other reasons that go extra musical. I want to go there, named Stan Kenton. No. Fourth, Charlie Parker died in 1955, so he wins. Now, finally, in 1956, Duke Ellington wins. He missed for the first time by this month. And then Benny Goodman. It's great, something to be proud of. All right, back in 1949, there was an all-time poll in Metronome, and top small group and top instrumentalist, Benny Goodman. Although, ironically, here's Artie Shaw's picture on the cover. Happy birthday. A few months ago, probably the last person, and excuse me, sorry, I'm glad we're making it through this. The last person from the big band era died at the age of 104. It's Louise Tobin, who sang with his band and was married to Harry James. Jose Farrar. He's 55. 1977. Here's a gold mine. You know, this was about records. So, again, Wynton Marsalis, who's done good things for bringing, but who's the article about? Benny Goodman, Lionel Hampton. Benny Goodman won loads and loads of polls, of course. But even in the last few years of his life, 1986, the year he dies, he comes in third place in clarinet. And this is just a cute thing. Here's Lionel Hampton, and what you see, what he's wearing around his neck is exactly what you think it is. A mezuzah. He wore it throughout, and if you listen to his music, very often he'll have an improvisation that'll begin like this. If you listen to a song called Thai Silk, you'll hear that. He raised a lot of money for hospitals in Israel. Lionel Hampton. He believed he was part of every religion. So did Louis Armstrong, by the way.
Louis Armstrong.
So, anything we'd like to discuss? I hope you have questions. Yes, Steve? Well, it certainly was great that he was able to have it, but it was also George Duvivier played, but also even a more famous bass player played with him. No, Slam Stewart. Slam Stewart, who was part of Slim and Slam. Slim Galliard. You ever hear of him? Or Voti, all different types of, who, by the way, was part Jewish, ironically. You would know that. But of course it helped. You know, it was not easy what they did with the four-piece group. Teddy Wilson was the most important one in that group. He kept everything together. Any other points, any other questions, anything? Yes, Evelyn. And even though not everyone was Jewish, many were. Charlie Barnett certainly wasn't. He was very, and the other way around too. There were a couple of black musicians who were quite influential. Now, I think the first black musician that I think had white musician in his band was a great musician named Benny Carter. Now, Benny Carter was one of the Kennedy Center recipients. Excellent, very important musician. But that's a nice explanation and something very proud of. Yeah, Hank, but again, Hank Greenberg wasn't given an easy time either. But it's a wonderful thing to me that these, oh, there's one story that took place. Now, Teddy Wilson was from Texas, and they played in Texas once, and they were given a delivery of champagne, and there was some police individual who heard the musicians referred to as Mr. Wilson, Mr. Hampton, didn't like it. So he gave a little bit of a hard time, but Benny Goodman reached out to that police officer's boss who loved their music, and that police officer got into trouble. That's the only time I've ever heard of anything related to it. I'm sure traveling in the South was not easy. You know who really got around all of that very intelligently? The one, Duke Ellington. You would take a Pullman car, and they would just live on the Pullman car. So they would eat there, they would not have any of the trouble. And you know who else did that? Cab Calloway. They were the only ones who did that. They had the finances to do it, so they did it. What else can we discuss? At home, I gotta tell you something. These CDs are great for this because CDs take up absolutely no space whatsoever. You get rid of the covers, they're called jewel boxes, and you can have thousands of CDs. I have a storage unit. I have a bunch of instruments there. So it's a challenge. I don't think anybody's watching this right now from home, but it would be. I have one more selection I want to play for you. I'll jump in at the very end. It's also from the Carnegie Hall concert. much. I'm sorry I wasn't in better voice, but I really love doing this with you tonight. And I hope that you maybe listen to their music. It's so easily available now. You can just pick it up on the internet. It's so different than when I started collecting and everything was so difficult to get. So thank you very, very much for coming. One? No, Louis Prima had his own band. Yeah, Chris Columbus, yeah, but he had his own band. Yes, that's right, he did. Thank you. Any other? Yes, sir. Oh, no, they played. The small group usually did, but I think that people enjoy listening. I certainly think it's good to keep going. They were basically up-tempo, but most of the things that I picked for different programs are up-tempo. But they really won mostly up-tempo. Thank you. Thank you.
The bars on a marimba are like concave. The bars on a xylophone are not cut in. They're thick throughout. Yeah, you get a much, much harder, sharp sound than a xylophone. This is a little baby marimba. There are small xylophones. There are big ones. They come in different sizes. This is it.